that from the days when the first telephones were invented. You know, the Jews have this tradition, they say, to speak with their hands. And if you remember, not personally, of course, the old telephones, you had to hold the body of the telephone with one hand and the handset with the other. So the Jew asked, if you have to, one, the right hand with the body and the left hand with the handset, how do you speak? But they always try to switch hands and at least they have one hand free. I'm very honored to be here, truly honored, even more so to open, to be the first speaker of this very distinguished conference. I must say, before I start, a word not to confuse anyone. The positions I am going to present here are not necessarily all of them positions currently of the government of Israel. I personally have a very, very good, I can even say, close relation with Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. I endorsed him in the last elections in February 2013, campaigned for him. I sometimes give him some advice, but he's the Prime Minister, he has the prerogative to accept my advice or to reject it. Sometimes he does reject it. And especially in the issue of the two-state formula to achieve peace in the Middle East, we do have some differences of opinion. Although many of his cabinet ministers, the views I represent, are and staunchly endorsed by them. Now, being said that, and I know that during the last 20 years at least, and there are some that would say the last 75 years, even before the creation of the State of Israel, the only game in town regarding the resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian or the Jewish-Palestinian conflict has been the so-called two-state formula. In other times it was called the partition plan, and later it assumed the denomination of two-state formula. To that extent, it was the only game in town that for many persons in the West, they seem to think that there is no other alternative. I think that one of the problems that the fact that the two-state formula, meaning the creation of a Palestinian state in Judea and Samaria and Gaza, the way to resolve the conflict in the Middle East, to that extent it was a star in the diplomatic world, the two-state formula, that it caused damage in the sense that it prevented innovative thinking, it prevented unusual thinking, because everyone thought that, you know, there was that saying, we all know what is the solution to the conflict, the only question is when will it happen? If that is the only question, then there is no point in trying to think about alternative solutions. My friend, the two-state formula, the creation of a Palestinian state, an independent Palestinian state in the so-called West Bank, in Judea and Samaria and Gaza, I sometimes say that it is the most aesthetic diplomatic formula I know. It's beautiful. It looks so nice. It apparently is perfect. It has only three shortcomings. It has only three problems. The first problem is that it's unattainable. It's impossible for Israel. I said, it was the only game in town for the last 20 years since the Oslo Accord, and in fact it's the only game in town since His Majesty King George of England sent the Royal Commission to the area in the 30s and proposed exactly that. And we are not there. The second problem that the two-state formula has, contrary to what the New York Times and the Guardian say, it's not a just solution to the conflict. And the third shortcoming this formula has, maybe the biggest one, it's not a solution at all. If implemented, I think I can prove mathematically that it will ignite a new war. So beautiful, beautiful, but hard to call it a solution. I would like to elaborate very briefly about those three points that I started. It's unattainable, it's not a just solution to the conflict, and it's not a solution at all. Let's start with the feasibility of this formula. My friends, I will be very indiscreet now and say something that maybe I shouldn't say. But you can't doubt the sincerity of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu when he talks about the two-state formula. You know that he adopted that formula. He adopted that in 2009 in his Bar-Ilan speech in the Bar-Ilan University in Israel, in Ramat Gan, not far from Tel Aviv. And there are people that say that he really did not adopt it sincerely, that he's bluffing the whole world. As I said, I know Prime Minister Netanyahu. I had many Netanyahu hours alone and in other forums. And I will tell you the truth. I myself don't know the answer to that question. There are mornings in which I wake up and I think that Prime Minister Netanyahu is sincere. There are mornings in which I wake up and I think that Prime Minister Netanyahu is indeed bluffing the whole world. And I suspect that the same thing happens to Netanyahu himself. He hasn't decided yet if he's serious or not. But there is one person you cannot doubt his commitment to the two-state formula. And that person is Mr. Netanyahu's predecessor, former Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. Prime Minister Ehud Olmert was so committed to the two-state solution that he made a statement that, in my view, is the most un-Churchillian statement that a leader can make. He said, if we do not establish a Palestinian state in Judea and Samaria, Israel is lost. I think a Prime Minister, I told him, a Prime Minister cannot, Churchill would never, in even more difficult situations, wouldn't say a thing like that, which is different, but it is. And I will give you one example. I could give a dozen examples. But I will give you one example of what did Prime Minister Olmert offer Mahmoud Abbas, the Palestinian president. Regarding Jerusalem, for instance, Prime Minister Olmert offered Abbas that the holy bastion of Jerusalem, meaning the old city and the city of David and Mount of Olives, really the most important, the most sacred, the wailing wall, the Kotel Maravi, the Temple Mount, the heart of Jerusalem, the heart of the Jewish people, was to be administered by five states, according to his proposal, five states, three of them Muslims. A majority, actually giving the Muslims the rule, the government of Jerusalem, the three. three Muslim states were the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the Kingdom of Jordan, the State of Palestine that we have established in that case, Israel, and the United States of America. And even that outrageous offer by Prime Minister Olmert was adamantly rejected by Abbas. So, I will tell you this, if the proposal given by Ehud Olmert to Mahmoud Abbas was rejected, you should read, by the way, the memoirs of former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. She says, she writes there that she ran into the Oval Office and told President George W. Bush, "Mr. President, the guy is serious, Olmert, but much more serious than even you thought." And even that offer was rejected by Abbas. That means that there is no point, there is no political formulation based on two states that will satisfy the appetite of the Palestinians. And the reason is that, unfortunately, the Palestinians have not come to terms with the very existence of an independent, sovereign Jewish state in the land of Israel or even in Palestine. And all other things are excuses. I said also that the two-state formula is not a just solution to the conflict. There are persons that, you know, it's almost an axiom in the international community and in the European Union especially, that the two-state formula is the just solution to the conflict. In my very strict moral standard, in my very strict understanding of what justice is and what morality is, I'm sorry, it is not the just solution. And I want to explain very briefly why. There are two claims to the same patch of land that we call Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, and they call Palestine. So you really could say that the just solution is partition. It makes sense. But ladies and gentlemen, what happens when partition is suggested? Is actually suggested by the United Nations, for instance, in 1947. One party accepted, although the partition did not include Jerusalem in the Jewish state, that it was a tiny, very difficult to manage state, but we accepted it. We went to the... I didn't, because I wasn't born yet, but the Jews of the land and even in Buenos Aires and New York and maybe not Budapest, maybe even Budapest, went to the squares of the cities to dance the aura to celebrate. And that very same night, the other side not only rejected the partition, it started a war to take it all by force. After that, is partition a just solution? In my view, no. Because that means you tell the aggressor, start a war. If you win, you take it all. If you lose, nothing happens. We go back to square one. That's not moral. Aggression should have a price. But it was not a one-time mistake by the Arab world and by the Palestinians. Let me remind you, ladies and gentlemen, that from 1948 till 1967, the so-called West Bank and Gaza were in Arab hands. They could have signed a peace treaty with Israel, with that border, with East Jerusalem in there as their capital. But what did you instead? They established the Palestine Liberation Organization in 1964, the PLO, the famous PLO, in order to liberate